Today's seminar will be given by Yuri Cherniak. He received his PhD in radio physics in 2009 from the National Academy of Science of the Ukraine Yuzhikov Institute of Radio Physics and Electronics, and he's spent many years researching the ionosphere, including a wide range of instruments based on radio propagation and satellite measurements in order to study space weather ionosphere effects. His research interests focus on study of structure, dynamics, and morphology of the ionosphere as a system, in particular processes of plasma irregularities development using multiple instrument techniques. And since this past July, he joined the UCAR Cosmic Program as project scientist, and he will discuss today about GNSS as a global observing system for ionosphere study.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Nick, for introduction, and thank you for coming. It's next seminar related with ionospheric observation after Nick Zabotin, and I will focus it on another type of observation for ionospheric study based on GNSS river propagations. And short outline of my talk, it's consists of overview of GNSS technique, how ionosphere specified in global scale by GNSS total electron content, and study of ionospheric irregularities, investigation of large scale lateral ionospheric disturbances, and some recent study related with ionospheric response to Great American Eclipse in last August. So ionosphere, it's complex system, and plasma density distribution in ionosphere affected by different driver and have different variability. So for investigation of this medium, applied different technique, and actually mainly based on radio physics, on radio wave propagation. Benchmark, it's ionosphere technique that allow estimate without any biases electron density up to F2 layer peak. More powerful facilities in its incongruent scale radars that allow estimate not only density but different parameters like temperature and ion composition. Of course, new era, it's GNSS based technique, including radio occultation technique like Cosmic GRACE and other mission, and direct measurements of electron content from the ground. Ionosonde is still a valuable source, but actually exists about 40 stations, and it's distributed not uniform in global. Of course, exist efforts to assimilate this data in global scale. One of projects is EARTAM, it's an assimilation of ionosonde data in quasi real time to obtain global ionospheric specification. But exist a lot of interpolation areas, and it's this observation difficult to apply to study ionospheric response to space weather event. Most powerful technique is incongruent scale radar. Currently exists 10 radars, and I worked in this facility, the single radar on mid latitudes. It's very interesting facility, but for observation and especially for monitoring of ionospheric condition permanently, it's not applicable due to it's very expensive facility, very power, and they works only several weeks per year during some ionospheric incongruent scale radar observation campaigns. New technique that appear on satellite on Genesis Era. It's technique based on estimation of radio signal parameter that transmitted by navigation satellite. Currently exist several constellations like GPS, Beidou, GLONASS, and exist so-called navigation field, and possible to estimate ionospheric impact on radio waves that passes through the medium, and retrieve at least number of electron in light of sight between receiver and satellites. And main parameter, it's total electron content. It can be slant, vertical, and ground-based networks grow very rapidly from beginning, and this number of station that was available in 1996, it was a little bit more than 100. Every station can estimate ionospheric electron content over area about 10 degrees, of course, depending of applied technique. Actually, for example, for 2017, available more than 6,000 stations globally, and more than 3,000 stations, it's multi-genesis station that provide data from both constellation, at least GPS and GLONASS, because only two constellation fully deployed now. And ionospheric specification by using GPS observation started in early from 1995-6, and one of organization that provide observation of ionospheric total electron content, it's IGS, it's International Genesis Service. This data are used for some practical application like mitigation of ionospheric error in navigation, but also widely used for different tasks of study, especially for ionospheric climatology. This product, it's low resolution product based on 100 stations in special resolution 2.5 degree on 5 degree, and standard temporal resolution of this product is 2 hours. Of course, currently this product updated, and some experimental IGS maps produced with 1 hour resolution and less. And exist several processing centers that generate global ionospheric content maps. These maps available in standard format, but every processing center use different approaches for estimation TC biases, different set of station, and different technique for interpolation. So resulted products also different, especially for equatorial latitudes where strong gradients can occur. Another approach, it's global total electron content map that not used interpolation smoothing, only real data. Most known, it's a product generated by MIT, and they produce maps with 2.2 degree, and every 5 minute, and cutoff, it's as important parameters that impact on accuracy of this product, but they apply 7 degree elevation angle in order to cover a wider area. Our team use the same approach when no interpolation use it, and apply our approaches for processing of all available freely available data in a global scale, but we use combination of two constellations, GPS and GLONASS, and it allow to first produce maps up to 5 meter resolution and 0.5 degree resolution in space, and apply cutoff angle 30 degree. It's allow to mitigate different errors that can occur when absolute values of total latent content was calculated. This is one of sample of such maps. It's constructed for 2015 June geomagnetic storm, and this map reproduces quite time storm time onset, positive phase and negative phase of this geomagnetic storm, and it allows to study evolution of electron content in high details. And another important question that raised in satellite era, it's impact of top side of ionosphere above F-tolerant peak, and how ionosphere plasmasphere system impact of total electron content. In this area, we face this problem of absence of Earth mission with topsize sounder. 30 years ago, fly several ionosondes, satellites with topsize ionosondes, and allowed to estimate topsize electron density profiles. And only a few low Earth orbit missions with in situ electron density measurements. Currently, it's only SWARM and DMSP. And also, due to absence, due to lack of observation, of course, exists problem of representation of topside electron density and electron content by empirical model. And currently, for different application, required total electron content specification, at least for radio wave propagation and navigation task. And recently, ESO standard committee strongly recommend to extend at least IRI model toward plasmasphere specification. And what way to acquire new information, new knowledge about plasmaspheric electron contents. It's obviously that total electron content composed with ionospheric electron content and plasmaspheric electron content. But how we can estimate contribution of plasmaspheric electron content to the total electron content? It's only combination of different measuring technique. What technique available now? Ionosondes, low orbit satellites in Kuiper Skin Trader, and ground-based GPS Genesis observation. So for global estimates of plasmaspheric electron content, possible involve only ground-based permanent navigation networks and GPS placed on orbit. Up to 2015 was a period very interesting mission GOCHE that fly on very low orbit, about 250 kilometers, and equipped by GPS receiver. At the same time, operate several mission, at least TerraSol mission, fly in the same local time sector like GOCHE. So it's possible to estimate impact of every altitude range to the ground-based electron content and divide on different range and estimate how it varies in a global scale. Here it's ground-based total electron content. It's electron content obtained from Gauss orbit, and it's 250 kilometers, and from TerraSAR orbit 500 kilometers, and you can see how varied impact of topside ionosphere to ground-based total content, and also that even density from altitude of 500 kilometers noticeable to the noticeable impact to the total ionization from ground. And in some case, like low solar activity or night, plasmaspheric electron content can impact more than 50% of total ground-based content. Another interesting feature of ionosphere plasma distribution is its ionospheric irregularities. It's known that ionospheric irregularities occurred in two regions, its equatorial region, equatorial anomaly, plasma bubbles, and high altitude ionospheric irregularities, mainly related with energetical particle precipitation and then other space weather events. And presence irregularities on way between receiver and transmitting satellite impact of on the signal parameters. And by analyzing signal parameter possible to detect these irregularities and estimate them severity. It was introduced several few GPS derived indices rate of TAC like its differential total electron contents and standard deviation of total electron content at its rate of TAC index. And how it's how these indices changed when some space weather event occur. This graph present diurnal variation of rate of TAC index for strong storm in 2004 for high latitude station Kiruna. For quiet condition, it's practically no variation in this index. But after storm onset, after beginning of aurora activity, practically all satellite link affected by ionospheric irregularities. And for specification of ionospheric irregularities in global scale, in similar way like global ionospheric maps, it will develop a new product that accepted by international NSS service. It's a global routing maps. Currently, this product available only for northern hemisphere because main users located here, and these maps represent ionospheric irregularities occurrence on daily basis and represent appearance irregularities in magnetic local time coordinates. Database, it's 700 representative stations, and it's of course it's low resolution product, but it's only first stage. I am the developer of this product and executive person for generation of this maps. This product available on CDDs since and data covered since 2014. This product have a very good agreement with pattern of aural precipitations, and using this of this data, we studies different space weather events. One of this it's St. Patrick's storm. It was largest storm in last 10 years. During the storm, I observed very intensive particle precipitation, and aurora appeared on mid latitudes. It was recorded that the storm impact on Genesis positioning performance. Dynamic snapshot of rate of TAC index and irregularity occurrence over few chains of stations. It's European and American sector and Antarctica sector. And for this event was registered a sudden increase in number of atmospheric irregularities described by a rate of TAC index, and they appeared on mid latitudes in both hemispheres. And if we look globally for quiet day, it's possible to recognize overlike pattern on both hemisphere, but it's located around 70 degrees. And for disturbed day, this pattern changed dramatically, and it's extend to mid latitudes and even to latitudes of Denver and San Francisco. So this approach of rate of TAC mapping allowed to recognize main feature of irregularities occurrence. What interesting is that for this specific storm was observed so call it storm tan enhancement density structure and irregularity embedded into the this structure clearly seen in even in daily rate of TAC maps, of course seen recognized oval and structure related with our particle precipitations. How it's look in when we superimpose both total electron content maps and rate of TAC maps, and we can see that storm time enhanced density structure very located in the same area than irregularities detected by a rate of TAC technique, and evolution of this structure and also circulation cells pattern also can be recognized in rate of TAC maps. Another interesting feature that Sato structure was observed not only over southern hemisphere but over the northern of the Antarctica, and even magnitude of storm time enhancement was more stronger in southern hemisphere. This data demonstrate total electron content and set structure coming from South America region and how it's involved in circulation and enhancement of plasma density derived from swarm plasma probe on altitude 500 kilometers, and show that density increased at least on one order. And this graph demonstrated evolution of Sato structure, and also very interesting that for this case swarm satellite cannot able to track GPS and due to presence of strong atmospheric irregularities, but another satellites that fly a little bit outside this area track strong irregularities in GPS signals. Another interesting feature of storm atmospheric response, it's travel atmospheric disturbances. Dense network of GPS receiver allow to track original propagation of LSTIDs in global scale. This global pattern of LSTID propagation for again for St. Patrick's storm, and it was recognized very long wavefronts, about more than 10,000 kilometers, and it was observed simultaneously in Europe and American sector, and also propagation from southern hemisphere and crossing of geomagnetic equator. Few slices for different sectors that allow to estimate time of origin, velocity of propagation, and how it's related with overall electrojet index. For this case, it was estimated wavelengths, main wavelengths of LSTIDs about 2,000 kilometers, and wave period more than 1 hour, and velocity of propagation about 700 kilometers. Another strong storm of 2015 was occurred in June. For this case was not recognized strong set-to-wave structure, and pattern of atmospheric irregularities in high latitudes show the similar to St. Patrick structure, like overall oval, but very interesting that in latitudes about 40 degrees was observed also some plasma irregularities. And when we start studying this structure in detail, we found that these irregularities come from equatorial latitudes, and it's show typical three bubble structure, most characteristic for equatorial regions. And when we look on total electron contents from ground, we found that this structure in rate of TEC values correspond to the depletion of total electron contents. The same depletion recognized in plasma probe of swarm satellites that fly over this area. The same depletion was recognized in total electron content of GPS from GPS receiver flight on board satellite, swarm satellite. For this case, also registered very enormous situation with navigation accuracy of VAS system. It's a system, the European system that applied for aviation and marine navigation. And accuracy decreased in 10 times. And in order to justify that it's plasma bubble structure, we analyzed several satellite passes, ground base data, and the bubble signature, typical bubble signature, was recognized in several swarm passes. TC data from a receiver on board swarm, and also it was recognized in the MSP data. So it's first time this similar structure was observed in mid latitudes, and nobody not expect, and it's can clearly impact on some safety of life systems like aviation navigation. And another not storm, but another space weather event that can impact on of ionosphere and give some information how it how ionospheric response occurred. It's solar eclipse. It was very interesting event, and solar eclipse cross area with very good coverage of ground-based GPS receivers. And for this event was registered maximum decreasing of total electron content of about 50%. Of course, this depletion was different for different longitude, because this eclipse occurred in different local times. And what interesting is that after eclipse was registered some total electron content enhancement, and how it's looks in dynamics. It's maximum obscuration, depletion, and enhancement. And enhancement most pronounced in western part and northern part of path of totality. It's also interesting that path of totality was on particularly the same magnetic latitudes, and we estimate that this enhancement was combination of flux from above and processes on below. It's like two concurrent mechanisms. Of course, it should be investigated separately, including first principle modeling. And main feature of this atmospheric response, it's different delay, different depletion. This how I say this effect of atmospheric response in morning time, noon time, and close to evening. And maximum delay was near center of continent, and maximum recovery time was on east part of continent. It's like a summary of these effects. And what about perspectives of Genesis-based technique for atmospheric study? Currently, fully deployed only two navigation satellite systems, but in recent time will be available at least Galileo, currently operated 14 satellites, and the Beidou system also operate 15 satellites. Will be developed several regional navigation system, and in fact will be available more than 100 satellites, and it give opportunity to sound ionosphere with unprecedented temporal and spatial resolution. For example, for actually existing multi-satellite station Canberra, it's available for one epoch about 30 satellites. And another opportunity, it's application of multi-GNSS on satellites that fly on low Earth orbit, including satellite that able to make radio occultation sounding. For actual cosmic mission, use it only GPS. For Cosmic 2 that will launch in near future, use it three constellation receiver that able to track GPS, GLONASS, and Galileo, and that will give opportunities to collect a very big number of profile and cover all of course, first constellation will cover only equatorial latitude, but can get a lot of data, not only total electron content, but real electron density profiles that can be useful for atmospheric specification and space weather studies. Thank you for your attention. It's for this case we make averaging of two 1 day before eclipse, 1 day after eclipse, and also we examined how diurnal variation different from climatology, for example, Irian Eckwick model. Because normal diurnal variation have some minimum around local noon and then go down after sunset.
So that means that the enhancement is not just the daily cycle.
Yes. Because for this case, shape of diurnal variation over station, no, it's not only for GPS, but the same signature was derived from ionosphere measurements. Noticeable change it and.
Right, but I mean, clearly the ionosphere did this on that day, but that doesn't necessarily mean that the eclipse caused it, something else that could have caused it. Now, we see all these other wave-like structures, inverse backward storm effect spreading out globally. Those seem clearly related to the eclipse. I'm not sure if the model correctly
captures this enhancement
along the
path of the valley or not. But it certainly seems to be there in beta. I just, there's been some speculation as well. Yes, and of course, one of explanation about it's like day-to-day variability. But main feature that shape of day-to-day variability changed. So also, if you look, for example, of on F10.7 index, how it's varied on day surrounding eclipse, it's not also demonstrated such strong variability that can get noticeable enhancement. It's also interesting that in a paper of Johuba was founded some enhancement in opposite hemisphere. And maybe it's possible, maybe for example in Huba model it was a different constant of travel of plasma to the hemisphere, and maybe it's possible, maybe if this constant, possible to change this constant, plasma go up and then go down and can lead to such an enhancement signature. Of course, it's
in that model, it's constant. Mm-hmm. And in the modeling we've been doing that has the neutral atmosphere affected by the eclipse, you see clear signatures of TID light disturbances that are, must be caused by neutral perturbations. And then many other things. I was just focusing on this post-eclipse enhancement without a question about it. I'll have to look at that part.
For eclipse? No, we looks in detail for southern hemisphere because again, if you look on number of stations for southern hemisphere, for case of eclipse, we collect 6,000 stations. It's not only network of UNAVCA, but several regional network. For southern hemisphere, it's not possible to estimate total electron content in the same details. But we checked and not found any response in low resolution data. No, it's a different goal of these maps. MIT maps, it's like a Vox-like service, like quasi-real time or some historical data, but they produce day-by-day maps and try to cover area most like with using this low elevation angles, and also MIT have access to Chinese stations. For normal user, it's not available. And we make these maps only for some cases. For yes, no. Because for service exists some errors, some like it's like hotspots, and for every service necessary to make additional quality control, and for these maps it was done during this map producing. Thank you very much.